أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين، وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآله الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. ربي أنتكنا بالهدى وألهمنا التقوى. السلام عليكم everyone ورحمة الله وبركاته. I begin in the name of Allah, the most kind, the most merciful. It's due to that kindness and mercy that we have these opportunities where we gather in remembrance and glorification of Him, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. I pray that the days of Shahr Ramadan are treating you well, and that in turn we are treating this holy month with the dignity that it deserves, inshaAllah. We have been discussing, or we started the discussion on the story of Prophet Dawood alayhi salam. We have yet to really inculcate the story of Prophet Dawood, but there is a backstory that is important, for it connects directly to Prophet Dawood alayhi salam. And we were describing the condition or the hal of the Banu Israel at that time. They were abased, they were subjugated, they were oppressed. And so they went to the prophet of their time, Ishmael or Samuel alayhi salam. And they asked him that, look, appoint for us a king. So he goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have Allah select a king that will take them to battle and fight the oppressors. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes back and he says that I have selected Talut as your king. They objected, of course, and they said, how can it be, right? That we are more deserving of kingdomship than he is. And he is not a wealthy person, right? Like, how can a non-wealthy person, a poor person, be the king over us? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replies back with two answers that will squash their objections. The first one is that, look, I have chosen him. You asked me to choose him, I have chosen him. That alone should be satisfactory. That Allah has decided on a matter, we no longer have any decision in that matter. And this is a philosophy of life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. وَإِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولَهُ أَمْرًا, that if Allah and His Prophet have decided on a matter, that you don't have a decision on this matter anymore, right? And as far as him being poor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have given him knowledge and physique, yani strength. And this knowledge comes before physique. And so this means that his strength is governed by the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. After having their questions answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, unfortunately this doesn't end their objections. Rather, they ask the prophet of that time to say, look, you have to give us proof. We can't just believe anything that you're saying. Which is really ironical, isn't it? But anyway, this is the hal of the questioners of this time. And again, like, I want us to be able to draw like examples from this into our own times, right? Without having me remind of these examples all the time, we have to be able to connect these dots. The purpose of Quranic stories are so that we can see our own condition, to see that, hey, are we very similar to what existed in previous communities, or have we, as we call it in Gujarati, sudhred a bit, right? Have we become better so that we're not making the same mistakes that others are making or others made prior to us? So they asked for proof of Talut's authority over them, to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ لَهُمْ نَبِيُّهُمْ, that their prophet said to them, إِنَّ آيَةَ مُلْكِهِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ التَّابُوتُ فِيهِ السَّكِينَةُ, that the sign of his kingdom is that they will come to you the chest, the tabut that we had mentioned in the first lecture, and in it, or with it, there will be sakina, tranquility, min rabbikum, wa baqiyatum mimma taraka alu Musa wa alu Harun tahmiluhu al-malaika, inna fi dhalika la ayatan lakum in kuntum mu'minin. He says, and you will find within them the relics of the children of Musa and the relics of the children of Harun, and that the angels will be carrying it, will be bearing it. Most surely there is a sign in this for those who believe. Now, the tabut is something that we had discussed previously, right? According to our traditions, this is the chest which the mother of Musa alayhi salam placed him in when she sent him down the river. What is this sakina, right, that Allah says will be accompanying this tabut? According to Allama Tabatabai, sakina refers to some type of divine spirit which comes from divine command, and with it, it creates tranquility in the heart. It creates satisfaction, firmness, and a peace of mind. And so when you have it, it automatically calms you down. And this is something that is not necessarily internal, rather it is a gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is providing. Now that they have received these signs, and imagine, the Allah is describing this so vividly, the angels will be carrying it, you'll get it back, you'll get tranquility. These, you would think, are enough signs for one to gain full conviction, full belief and firmness in whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then expects from them. After these signs, they now, I would say, I don't want to say begrudgingly, Allahu A'lam, but they now accept the leadership of Talut. But yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to test them, right? And I think this is really significant, that just because you have been given every sign of God, just because you have attained satisfaction in whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided, it doesn't mean that the tests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to an end. Rather, there is constant testing, yeah, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to weed out the true believers from those who just pretend to have belief, or who are only believers when things are going well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا فَصَلَ طَالُوتُ بِجُنُودِهِ قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مُبْتَلِيكُمْ بِالنَّهَرٍ فَمَنْ شَرِبَ مِنْهُ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتْعَمْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي إِلَّا مَنْ اِغْتَرَفَ غُرْفَةً بِيَدِهِ. He says that when he departed with his forces, he says that, look, Allah is going to test you with the river, and whoever from you drinks from this river is not from me. That means you can no longer accompany us. You are going to be sent back home. And whoever does not drink anything from it, then surely that person's or those persons are from me, except those who take with their hand as much of it that fills it. So we're going to discuss this in a second. But the purpose of these tests, again, are to test real conviction, right? And so they march with war gear, and they're marching. God knows how long they are marching for towards this battle. Surely they're thirsty. Surely when you see a river in front of you, your first reaction would be to go and test it, except you have been asked not to, right? And this is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Will we follow through with it? You know, this reminds me of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, huh? Subhanallah, in Karbala, that, you know, when he got to the river Furat, no one had told him not to drink water. Yeah, imagine us, right? Imagine me, like, I don't know, like, if I'm there, I'm thirsty, I'm taking water back for the family, but why not just have a sip along the way, right? Like you're going to go pick up like some dinner, and there's some warm fries in the car, and you know you're taking it back to your family. You might have a fry or two. It doesn't make you a bad person, right? I forget, we're fasting. Yeah, my bad. But Abu al-Fadl, no one told him not to. Yet his loyalty was such, subhanallah, his loyalty was such that he says, how can I drink water when my master Hussein is thirsty? May our fathers and mothers be sacrificed for Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. What a hero, what a hero, yeah? But these people had been commanded not to. Now, you've been commanded not to, I'm thirsty, but at the same time, God has given me signs, ayat. You know, it's not like it's ilmul ghaib in the sense that, like, okay, look, you have to believe in it, you've never seen it. You know, maybe those are our tests today, right? But these people had got the tabuts, they had got these signs back, and so they should have had that conviction. And this is something that Allah will constantly do, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will constantly test to see whether or not the faith that you and I have is real faith. Is it faith of true conviction or not? And this is why Allah says in Surah Al-Ankabut, Alif Lam Mim, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. This is like one of my favorite verses of the Quran, you know, because Allah says very clearly, right? Do people think that simply because they say they believe that I will not try them, that I will not test them, right? In fact, we know the more we profess it, the more we will be tested. And so the professing of faith is so important that it's not just lip service, but that we are grounded in Iman, right? And if we are grounded in Iman, then yes, we are going to be tested. We accept it. Right? There's nothing to be stressed out about. We are going to be tested. But the faith should push us and govern us and make sure that we don't trip and we don't fall, right, in these when these tests happen. What we see from these people, the Banu Israel, and this is the same verse that we had quoted, that according to Allama Tabatabai, there are three groups of people that are being mentioned here, because there is an exceptional clause, right, where it says, إِلَّا مَنِ اغْتَرَفَ غُرْفَةً بِيَدِي, except for one who takes a handful. So basically, you have three groups of people, right? The first group of people are those who drank their fill from the river, right? And these people were like no shame, they're like water, and they just ran to it and they drank it as much as they could. And what we hear, or what we understand, that majority of them drank it. Majority. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَشَرِبُوا مِنْهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِنْهُمْ. Subhanallah. Amazing. Amazing, right? Like, I think, and I wonder, you know, like, that the people who lived at the time of Nubuwa and were shown the miracles, like the sadna, like the she camel, and Nabi Isa's healing, and Nabi Musa's the serpent, and even the Prophet and the things that he did, the Quran. But besides that, there were so many ayat that were accompanying, right? How could they reject, right? How could they? These people were shown, yet majority, like over 90% of the people went and they drank from the water, yeah, without any shame. They just went and they drank. The second group of people are those who didn't drink anything, right? And they are considered to be part of the army of Talut, who said they had that full conviction to go forward. The third group of people are those who drank just a handful. So that's that exceptional clause. So you had one group who drank fully, didn't care. Other group who said, no, we were instructed not to drink, we're not going to drink. And then there was an exceptional clause, and said, and that is the people who took a handful of water. Now, because of this exceptional clause, according to Allama Tabatabai, these people were allowed to cross the river. Right, so the group that drank, Talut said, go back, you're done, right? And you have no part in this. The second group who didn't drink, you are part of my army. The third group, they did drink, but once they crossed, they had a handful of water, but once they crossed, you could see a lack of conviction in them, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا جَاوَزُوهُ هُوَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ. And when they crossed it, along with the faithful who are with them, قَالُوا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا الْيَوْمَ بِجَالُوتِ وَجُنُودِهِ. They said, like, we don't have any strength today. Like, we can't go on, right? Like, this is, let's take a break now. And this immediate lack of conviction was because they had that lack of conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Now, they didn't have disbelief in Allah, but they lacked it. You know, like, this is like very similar to, like, if you tell your child, like, your child, like, just is misbehaving, and you're like, fine, do it. Like, you said, do it, but you know you don't really mean it, right? And you can see, like, the child is like calculating, right? But when they do it, then they'll regret it later, right? If they do it. Or if they don't, then you're actually happier with them. In this case, Allah says, look, I don't want you to. But then if you take a handful, whatever, we'll see what happens, right? And so these people took a handful, and immediately they lost that conviction that they had. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا اللَّهِ كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرًا. Now then the other group of people said that, listen, what do you mean you don't have taqat? You don't have energy to go fight Goliath today. This is the story of Goliath, right? Those who are certain they will encounter Allah, they said, how may, look, we have seen this happen where a small party has overcome a large party with Allah's help. Wallahu ma'as sabireen, be patient. Allah is with those who are patient. Those who had no conviction were those who had full conviction and said this were those who didn't drink at all, right? Who were strict about listening to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And according to traditions, these people numbered only 313. Subhanallah. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam said the few who did not drink nor have a handful numbered in 313. Imagine, subhanallah, right? 60,000 drank, only this small number didn't drink. And of course this number 313 comes up all the time of true believers and of true people who are willing to be strict on themselves with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded. Now these 313 are going up against the army of Jalut, of Goliath, right? And they now encounter one another, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَمَّا بَرَزُوا لِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ, and when they went forth to face Goliath and his soldiers, these people who had full conviction, who acted on that conviction by not drinking water. You see, it's one thing to say, Ya Rabbi, amantu, amantu, I believe, but then you back it up with action, right? These people backed it up with action, and when they came in front of this large army of Jalut, what do they say? They turn to Allah Azza wa Jal, and they say, Rabbana afrigh alayna sabra wa thabbit aqdamana وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ, that our Lord pour upon us, أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا, pour upon us patience, yeah, and ثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا, and strengthen our feet, and help us and grant us victory over those who are disbelieving. This dua is really beautiful, right? This dua asks for three things which I think are essential in many, many circumstances in our lives. The first thing is pour patience upon us. Yani, this is not just give us back, pour it, like drown us in patience, Ya Allah. And right, like this, patience is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Naturally, we strive for it and we apply it, but at the same time, we must never lose focus that when we are patient, it's because Allah has seen us with the capacity to be patient, hence He pours it to the fill of our capacity. These people had shown tremendous capacity, and hence they were being poured upon with patience as they faced this army. The second thing that they ask for is what? Make our feet steady, right? Steadfastness against any challenges. Do not make me run. Do not make me turn away. Do not make me slip, but make my feet firm. I know what I stand for. I know what I believe in, and what I believe in and what I stand for are exactly what you want, O Allah. These are not personal stubbornness that I'm seeking, but it is stubbornness in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third is, وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ, assist us against those who transgress. This dua is very powerful, okay? It's very beautiful. Anytime, you know, you find yourself in a situation where your feet begin to tremble a little bit, you are overcome with emotions, ask Allah with this dua, right? And make sure that your conviction of asking is not just lip service, that you truly believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will assist you. And then why wouldn't God assist, right? Like, why wouldn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assist? I want us to recite this dua 3 times together, right? Just for the sake of practice. And then take a screenshot if you can, or if you would like, right? And remember this dua, or open the Quran and read it, right? Surah Baqarah verse 250. But let's recite this 3 times together, because I tell you, this dua is powerful, right? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين One more time. ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم الله سبحانه وتعالى answers their prayer. What would we expect, right? Except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would answer their prayer. And what does he say in this jawab? فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ They routed them with Allah's will. Yani they didn't, they routed them. Yeah, these 313 fought that army. And they routed them. وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودَ جَالُوتَ وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ And David killed Goliath. You know, this is the story of David versus Goliath. We told you this story links directly with Nabi Dawood alayhi salam. We must have faith. You know, this teaches us many lessons, but most importantly, we must have faith that Allah will not leave us alone. If we make the necessary sacrifices and have that conviction, Allah will always be there. Allah will always make us victorious, right? And so this is an important lesson, but at the same time, this is where we see the introduction of Nabi Dawood alayhi salam. And Nabi Dawood, this is that same Dawood. There are other karinas, there are other links that make us believe, but all Mufassirin believe, and that this is that Dawood who is the father of Sulaiman, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made one of his chosen prophets. And this is where we see that the entry of the story of Nabi Dawood. He is the one who defeated the one who was oppressing the Banu Israel and subsequently was given Nubuwah and Mulkiyah and kingdomship as well. So where did Dawood come from, right? Like, we didn't hear about him at all prior to this. We got a very lengthy tradition that describes this, right? This tradition is from our sixth Imam alayhi salam, who is reported to have said, Kana Dawood وَأَخُوهُ لَهُ أَرْبَعَةٌ وَمَعَهُ أَبُوهُمْ شَيْخٌ كَبِيرٌ That Dawood had 4 brothers, and their father was an old aged man. Dawood had remained back to look after the sheep of his father. So the other brothers went and they had joined the army of Talut. Dawood, being the youngest, was told to stay back, help the father, look after the animals. And so when Talut departed from his forces, Dawood's father called him and he told him that take this food for your brothers which I have prepared for them so that they may get strength to overcome the enemy. So Dawood alayhi salam departs, right? And the tafsir in another tradition continues that فَمَرَّ دَاوُودَ عَلَىٰ حَجَرٍ That at this juncture, he says, and Dawood, as he was taking this food, passed by a stone. فَقَالَ الْحَجَرُ يَا دَاوُودُ خُذْنِي فَقْتُلْ بِي جَالُوتُ فَإِنِّي إِنَّمَا خُلِقْتُ لِقَتْلِي He says that he would pass by a stone, and the stone spoke to Dawood and said to him, O Dawood, take me to kill Goliath with, because verily I have been created for this reason. So he took it and put it in his bag in which he kept the stones for his sling, which he used when he was herding sheep. On entering the army camp, he heard them greatly magnifying the affair of Goliath. And they were talking about how big their army was and so forth and so on. And they said, he said to them, "Why are you so overwhelmed with this? By Allah, if I see him, I will kill him." Thereupon they started talking with each other about it till he was brought before Talut. Talut asked him, "O young man, how much strength do you have? And what experience have you for yourself?" Dawood said, "It happens that if a lion attacks a goat of my herd and catches it, then I overtake him, catch his head, open his jaws, and rescue the goat from his mouth." Hearing this, Talut said, "Bring me a full-size coat of mail." Ud'uli bidir'in sabighatin. قال فأوتي بذرع فقذفها في أنقه فتملأ منها. Subhanallah. He says that a big, full-size male was brought, and obviously that means that he maybe was young. He didn't have that full jism or the body of somebody who was a warrior, but they brought like this big armor just to see how it would. And it was brought unto him, and he put it in Dawood's neck, and lo, his body filled it completely. Thereupon Talut and the Israelites who were present there were awestruck by him. And Allah and Talut said, "By Allah, most probably Allah will kill Goliath by him." When the morning came and the people gathered around Talut, and the people of the two forces stood against each other, Dawood said, "Show me Goliath." When he saw him, he took the stone and putting it in his sling, threw it towards him, and it hit him between his eyes. And Goliath fell from his steed, and the people cried, "Dawood has killed Goliath." Then the people made from their king until nobody was heard talking about Talut. And the Israelites gathered around Dawood, and Allah sent down Zabur to him and taught him the handicraft of iron, making it soft for him, and ordered the mountains and the birds to join in him, glorifying Allah. The Imam said, "And nobody was given a voice like him." Thereupon Dawood lived with the Israelites, hidden from them, and he was given strength to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of these words or these verses when he talks about Dawood. He says, "Wa ataahu Allahu al-mulk وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَعَلَّمَهُ مِمَّا يَشَاءَ. And Allah gave him the kingdom and wisdom and taught him what he pleased. And this is where we formally now get into the story of Nabi Dawood alayhi salam. Nabi Dawood alayhi salam is mentioned 16 times in the Quran by name. So for example, in this verse Allah says, "Ya Dawood, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard fahkum bainan nas bil haqq wa la tattabi'il hawa fayudhilluka an sabilillah." O Dawood, indeed we have made you a successor upon the earth to judge between the people in truth, and do not follow your own desires, for it will lead you away from Allah. And then in another verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Isbir ala ma yaqulun wadhkur abdana Dawood al-aidi innahu awwab." And be patient over what they, and remember of our servant, and remember our servant Dawood, the possessor of strength. Indeed, he was one who repeatedly turned back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now from the story we have already been told about Dawood and the events with Goliath or Jalut, we already know the bravery and the courage and the strength of Prophet Dawood alayhi salam. As for his conduct and his worship, it is said that Dawood was one of these servants of God who used to constantly stand up and pray to Allah. And in fact, he used to fast every other day. That means half the year Prophet Dawood alayhi salam would fast. In a tradition, Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam says that when the Prophet had been appointed to prophethood, he fasted day after day. So much so that they thought he will no longer break his fast. And then sometimes he didn't fast for many days, and they thought that he would never fast. That's where people are never happy. He would fast, oh, he's fasting too much. He didn't fast, look at this Prophet, he's not fasting. Then he started to fast one day and not fast the other days, like the fasting of Dawood. And finally, one more point before we end for today. The name Dawood comes from the joining of two words, Dawa Biwood. And it means that it is Dawood who, out of his love for Allah, would cure his own wounds with this love and affection that he had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So dawa bi wood is shortened to Dawood because he used to cure his own wounds, internal wounds, with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, if God gives us life, we will continue tomorrow. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa alihi at-tahirin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.